Welcome back to another episode of Introductory Organic Chemistry. Today we're going to talk about pKas, but before we get into that, let's go through the problems that I assigned in the last lecture. So in this first problem, we can see that we start with a ketone and we get an amine, and so we have to do some sort of reductive amination. And so in this case, I propose that you'd use this piperidine ring and treat this with hydrogen and palladium on carbon to do our reductive amination. Of course, you could always do reductive amination following the Bortsch reduction using sodium cyanoborohydride. But as last episode really illustrated, there's several different approaches that you can use to access amines from carbonyl-containing compounds. In the next problem, we have this multi-step synthesis from this styrene to acetophenone and finally this phenylethylamine. So initially what I would do is take this styrene, treat it with MCPBA to get an epoxide. This epoxide can then be opened at the primary position to give us this phenyl ethanol product, which can then be oxidized to acetophenone using an oxidant such as DMP. Now, once we have this acetophenone, all we have to do is treat it with ammonium formate, acid, and base, and this is going to accomplish the Eschweiler Clarke reaction, which will give us this NH2 product. Finally, I wanted to mention that if you wanted to get from this directly to the ketone, you could actually do a pinnacle type rearrangement, which is where you take an epoxide or a 1,2 diol and you treat it with an acid or a Lewis acid, and this will just rearrange it to a ketone instead of a 1,2 diol, or in this case, an epoxide. Okay, now in the final problem, we have benzene and we want to access this this nitrogen containing compound shown on the right. And so other than benzene, we're allowed to start with 1 and 2 carbon building blocks and all other normal reagents. So in the previous example, I didn't show a retrosynthesis, but for this example, I'm going to do retrosynthesis because this is a little bit more complicated. So if you're not sure how to get somewhere in the forward direction, it's sometimes useful to start in the opposite direction where you start breaking off parts of the molecule one at a time. So from this product, I think maybe if we wanted to install that nitro, we could just have a CH there before. If we wanted to install this ether linkage, we could probably do that from a phenol and this amine with a leaving group. Now, if we have that phenol, we could probably access that via an ester, which could have been the precursor before this was brominated to the CH analog. And finally, this acetate could be made via a Bayer-Villiger type oxidation. The last step would have to be something like a Friedel-Crafts. So in the forward direction, what we would do is we would take benzene, treat it with acetyl chloride in the presence of aluminum trichloride as a catalyst. This would give us acetophenone. Once we have acetophenone, we could do an MCPBA-mediated Bayer-Villiger oxidation to get this phenyl acetate product. We could then accomplish para-bromination with Br2. What we do have a little bit of an effect of is a slight steric effect that will help us bias towards the para position. And if we're worried about getting any orthobromination, we could usually find literature conditions for similar substrates that would give us the desired outcome. So since we need that nitrogen-containing thing with a leaving group, what I would propose as a starting material is this 2-carbon building block, which we could then undergo a Bortsch reduction to give us this reductively aminated product. Finally, if we want to make this OH into a good leaving group, we could mesylate it to make this into a mesylate or mesylate. This is a good leaving group. And so this is really well set up for the next step. Okay, so the first thing we would have to do is hydrolyze this ester. And so we could just do this with potassium hydroxide. That would make the phenoxide. And since it's already deprotonated, we could just put in our amine-containing mesylate, which would then undergo an SN2 reaction, affording this ether product. The last step of this transformation would be a nitration, which should give us orthoselectivity, as the oxygen is a much better orthoparadirector than the bromine is. And so hopefully this is really straightforward. There's other solutions that you could use to get the same product. This is just the route I've chosen. Let me know what you think of this route in the comments. So with that, let's get into today's material, an overview of pKas. So when we have a pKa for a given proton, this is essentially how easy it is for it to be deprotonated, or how much it wants to be deprotonated. And pKas are only useful relative to other bases or acids. So you can only tell if a base is going to be able to deprotonate a proton if you know the pKa of its conjugate acid. So the acidity of a proton is determined by several factors. One of the factors is its local chemical environment, which is a big way of saying basically anything that causes the proton to be influenced by anything at all. And so this could be affected by the element that the proton is bound to. Electronic effects, including inductive effects, which could be from electron density further away. There could be some steric effects. Resonance stabilization of the resulting like anion once the proton's been deprotonated, as well as the orbitals, whether there's an sp3 or an sp2 or an sp ch bond. Depending on which type of orbital is involved, this can affect the acidity of a proton as well. So another factor that's relevant is the solvent that this is dissolved in, which there's several complicating factors from this, including the dipole moment or the polarity of the solvent, whether or not there's good hydrogen bond acceptors or donors in the solvent. And one good rule of thumb is when you're looking at pKas, in general, things tend to be more acidic in water than DMSO. However, there are exceptions. So if you want a really good resource for pKas, I will include this link in the description, which has a collection of all of the different major pKa tables that different groups have organized. Additionally, Wikipedia will quite often have pKa data for some acids, but it's sporadic, and it would be really cool if one or two of you wanted to go and add pKa values to Wikipedia pages. And you know, it doesn't mean you have to go and add 100 of them, but even if each of you added like one, we'd get to a very more useful Wikipedia entry for all these compounds pretty quickly. No pressure, but if you did that, it would be pretty cool. So when we're looking at pKa, it's worth noting that it's logarithmic, just like N parameters are logarithmic. And so if you increase a pKa unit, like let's say a pKa of 10 to 11, the one unit increase would be the equivalent of a tenfold decrease in acidity. So something with a pKa of 11 is 10 times less acidic than something with a pKa of 10. So if you want to completely deprotonate a position, let's say you have something with a pKa of 10, you want to use a base which has a conjugate acid of a pKa of at least 13, i.e. 3 pKa units higher. And because this is 1,000 times less acidic, it should more or less entirely deprotonate that position. The remaining amount that would be not unprotonated or still protonated rather would be the equivalent of 0.1%, which is not usually that significant. And so while you don't necessarily need a base this strong in all cases, this would be one way to ensure that you get a fully deprotonated proton. Okay, so if you have some reactions that use base, these are usually concerted. So basically, like if you have an E2 reaction and you're thinking about, okay, what's the pKa of an alkane versus terbutanol? Well, terbutanol has a pKa of about 17, and so you might be surprised that terbutoxide is able to affect some elimination reactions, while the pKa of a CH is usually, you know, in the realm of like 40, but it depends on what the CH is. And so you might be surprised that terbutoxide is able to do eliminations, and the reason that this is complicated is you're not deprotonating in the first step and eliminating in the second step. It's all concerted, and there's some effect of the cation getting close to the leaving group, and so it's making it a little bit easier. There's solvent effects, and so it can be complicated if you think about it as like every instance where you use a base must be a discrete deprotonation, but that's not necessarily the case. So here I've included a big list of pKas that are worth knowing. Three common strong bases that are usually in their lithium base form are shown here, but these are their conjugate acids. So the pKa of diisopropylamine is 36 in THF. The pKa of hexamethyl disilazide is 26 in THF. The pKa of tetramethylpiperidine is 37 in DMSO. And for the rest of these compounds, I've included the pKas in water, because these tend to be more useful in my opinion. However, most of the pKas that have been experimentally determined are in DMSO. And so in the next couple slides, we're gonna see more examples of pKas in DMSO. So for something like water, water has a pKa of 15.7. However, if we protonate water further, H3O plus has a pKa of minus 1.7. If we have isopropanol, you can see that this is about tenfold less acidic than water, but it's relatively close, it's in the same ballpark. But if we have hydrogen sulfide compared to water, we can see that hydrogen sulfide is way more acidic comparatively. This is almost nine orders of magnitude more acidic. Okay, so then if we look at the carboxylic acids, we'll see a bit of a trend. So acetic acid has a pKa of about 5, TFA has a pKa of around 0, benzoic acid has a pKa of around 4, and carbonic acid's first proton can be deprotonated with a pKa of 3.6. However, the bicarbonate ion has a pKa of 10. Now, once we're going to the nitrogen-containing compounds, here you can see triethylamine in its protonated form has a pKa of 10.8. Pyridine has a pKa of 5.2 when protonated, while succinamide in its normal neutral form has a pKa of 9.5. Ammonium has a pKa of 9.2. However, if you want to deprotonate a second one of those nitrogens, it is way less acidic with a pKa of 38, highest on the chart so far. Now, if we look at acetone, you can see acetone has a pKa of 19.2. However, as soon as we add another electron withdrawing group on the other position, this becomes way more acidic, 10 orders of magnitude more acidic. And so when we have 1,2,1,3 dicarbonyl species, these are way more acidic than a single carbonyl-containing compound. If we look at something like phenylacetylene, this has a relatively low pKa compared to other CHs, where we have a pKa of 23. Here you can see for ethylene, the pKa is 50, so ethylene is not a very good acid at all. Benzene comparatively has a pKa of 43. If we have toluene, toluene's pKa is also in a similar range, but in that case it would be a benzylic. Now if we look at methane, methane has a pKa of 48. Propane's secondary position is the most acidic, and it has a pKa of 51. And finally, you can see that this isobutane has a pKa of 53. So tert butyllithium would be the strongest base, which is well known in organic chemistry. And so the majority of these values I obtained from this Evans pKa table. This is one of the many resources that chemists use to get pKa table values for a lot of compounds. If they're not available in Wikipedia, basically, this is what I would consult. Okay, so if we're looking at heterocyclic compounds, usually we're talking about five-membered rings with an NH, such as imidazole. They all have various different pKas, and for the less acidic ones especially, if you ever want to deprotonate them, you'll do this with sodium hydride. And so you might want to do an alkylation selectively at one position, and so that can usually be accomplished with sodium hydride. However, for some of these where you have multiple nitrogens present, you can often get mixtures of alkylation at different positions, especially once you have derivatives of these. Okay, so the majority of these have pKas that are known in DMSO, and that's because they're a little bit easier to measure. However, some of these also have pKas in water. And so you can see for something like imidazole, it's about four orders of magnitude more acidic in water than it is in DMSO. And this follows through as a trend for most of these. Now, I'm not going to go into too much detail on these other than to say that these are useful if you're trying to make derivatives of these. You can choose bases that are in the right ballpark. And if you have a similar or different heterocycle, you might want to consult Phil Barron's book. He has a really good book called The Portable Chemist's Consultant, which really describes heterocycle synthesis and reactions of heterocycles in general. It's probably the best resource, the most authoritative resource that summarizes lots and lots of papers, and you can find that on the Apple Store. Unfortunately, it's not available in PDF form to my knowledge. However, if you have found a PDF form of it, please comment down below and I'll pin that comment. The Barron group also has a good slide here talking about some of the pKas of different heterocycles, including CH pKas, and I'll include a link to this in the description. Okay. So if we have a carboxylic acid, we can really see an effect of electron withdrawing groups on pKa. And so here you can see with acetic acid, we have a pKa of 4.8. As soon as we add a chlorine, we drop the pKa to 2.9. With two chlorines, it drops it even further to 1.3. And three chlorines on the alpha position drops the pKa all the way to 0.7. And if we were to replace those chlorines with fluorines, it becomes even more acidic still, down to a pKa of minus 0.3. And essentially what this is doing is, as we get more electron withdrawing groups, this is having a stronger and stronger dipole moment. And what that means is it can stabilize the negative charge better once the proton's been removed. And so what this just means is, our rationalization is that because the conjugate base would be able to stabilize the charge more, it means that the protonated form would be more acidic. And so if you're not sure sometimes why certain things have a lower pKa than others, you might be able to rationalize this by looking at the presence of electron withdrawing groups. So this just summarizes what I just said. Okay, now if we look at benzoic acids, there's been much more work looking at the effect of substituents on the ortho, meta, and para position on the acidity of the benzoic acid. However, you shouldn't use these pKas as a proxy for nucleophilicity, even though in some cases, like shown here, you can see a correlation where the pKa of this benzoic acid is bigger than the pKa of this 4-nitrobenzoic acid, and correspondingly, the N parameter of benzoate is about an order and a half of magnitude higher than the N of 4-nitrobenzoate. However, the data set for benzoate nucleophilicity parameters is quite small, so you can't really draw too many conclusions just based off of this correlation. more work is needed by physical chemists to determine the end parameters of all of the various different benzoic acid derivatives, which currently have reported Hammett parameters. Now, Hammett is a researcher who examined the effect of these substituents on benzoic acids, and in the future, I'll do a full video on Hammett parameters. As this video is already getting kind of long, I'd like to keep that as a separate topic for a future video. So for this lecture, I'd like to assign three practice problems. First, with each of these four compounds, rank them in order of decreasing acidity, and also identify the most acidic proton in each molecules. If you're a well-versed chemist such as myself, this would be a trivial exercise, but for undergraduate students, this could be useful. In this next problem, I want you to predict whether or not the following reaction will occur, and if not, why not? And in this final problem, I'd like you to propose a base that can deprotonate acetophenone to make this enolate. And so with that, I hope that this has been a useful video on pKas. It would really help out the channel if you left a like and subscribe, and have a great day!